All right. Let's make a start. Just to tie up one or two loose ends, Kathy asked a question before, and that was very important. You know how when they release something or an issue to the Lord, I divorce them from it? Well, I do that in every case except for one. Better explain that. Except for a married couple. And in the case of a married couple, I do not use the word divorce. I don't care what he's been like or what she's been like. In that room where the spouse is, I don't use the word divorce. What we do there is we ask the Lord to reveal all the baggage. 20, 10, 20, 30, 40 years worth of baggage that's in the room. And we cut that off in Jesus' name. And then we ask the Lord into that room with the spouse. Just a variation on a theme. With the spouse. So that the spouse and Jesus are now occupying that room. And it is just incredible. Some of the stuff that happens and some of the stuff that clients experience when Jesus and their spouse is in there. And if you ever go down that path and ask the Lord to do it, just be open to a whole range of things that the Lord can do there. This was a woodcut that one of my clients made, and that's how she represented in a woodcut what the Lord did for her. Can you see how it's like her wound was sexual abuse? And as the Lord cut through and cut down and cut deeper and cut deeper, at the end, there wasn't the trauma and fear that she thought she may have at the end. What she found there was the cross. In other words, the Lord's presence. So that was a real healing to her. But she made that woodcut just to symbolize the process that she went through. All right, we're changing gears a bit now. I'm going to talk about this book that I read about 25 years ago. This is my last copy. Adult Children of Legal or Emotional Divorce. This is always a very sensitive topic. But adult children is now no longer called adult children. It's now called the inner child. I once Googled inner child and came up with between 30 to 40 million references to the inner child. So it's not something that I'm making up on the spur of the moment. It's something that's very real. And the inner child is something I want to talk to you about. You see, if we've cleaned out the rooms, we've jackhammered the core belief systems that have just about ruined their lives, but there's some other damage that life has done to them that we need to repair. And that is the formation of an inner child. Now, here's how it goes. Now, I have said this to nearly every client that I have ever had. So if it sounds a bit rote, a bit anything, is everything okay there? Okay. So here's what I've said to nearly every client that I've ever had. And I can almost parrot it now, unfortunately, but here goes. I believe we're made out of a body, a soul, and a spirit. We eat our beans and peas and broccoli and cabbage and spinach and spaghetti. I'm being culturally relevant. And we grow up on the outside. Beans and peas and broccoli and cabbage and spaghetti and spinach will not grow up our spirit and our soul combo. Our spirit and soul, and I use the word combo, because Macca's and Hungry Jack's use the word combo. And I think it's appropriate to use that as well. So, all that food will grow our physical bodies up, but it will not grow up our spirit and soul combo. Then I ask them a question. What is the only thing that will grow up our spirit and soul combo from day one? Thank you. Love emotional vitamin pills taken 3 times a day with meals. I'll repeat it again. Love emotional vitamin pills taken 3 times a day with meals. If a kid does not get their love emotional vitamin pills 3 times a day with meals, and 2 months ago I heard it described as LDD, love deficit disorder. If they don't get their love emotional vitamin pills 3 times a day with meals, I want to tell you what happens to them. There is a formation, their body keeps growing because of the nourishment, but their spirit and their soul combo actually dies and gets malnutritioned. In sexual abuse, they die. In many forms of physical abuse, they can die. But what remains inside is a starving refugee, malnutritioned of love, skin and bone, like you see on TV, and covered in love-sucking leeches. Not blood-sucking ones, love-sucking leeches. Now, if you feel free and comfortable in doing this, how many people in this room have actually sensed that little child at one stage in their life that was malnutritioned of love? Thank you, hands down. That's how prominent it is. If you haven't felt it, if you don't know what I'm talking about, you are blessed. Because it means you've had the love emotional vitamin pills 3 times a day with meals, or it means that their inner child is there, but you haven't recognized it. And it leaves... If you can't recognize a little child, arms, legs, or whatever, never else, then you may be able to recognize a deep sense of pain that just is always in the background, and it just tends to surface every now and then, and it always surfaces at the wrong time and makes your life miserable and all that kind of stuff. So it's that inner child that is very special in the ministry. If someone has been sexually abused, I just have to ask them, how old's that little child in there? Is there a little child in there? Yes. Or, do you feel that deep sense of pain in the background? Yes. How old is it? 5, 9, 7, 12, 15. So, what happened when you were 12? Oh, well, I wasn't going to tell you. But that's when I was sexually abused. And that's when they die. That's when that little kid dies. It's quite an amazing thing. It's a horrible thing. The devil knows that that kind of abuse is one of the worst/best ways for destroying a human being. Okay, which is why I deal a lot with the inner child. And when we've been through the rooms, and when we've fixed up that concrete slab and jackhammered it to pieces, we can then, and sometimes even before, it depends, even before, sometimes we then go on to growing up that inner child. Because it was love emotional vitamin pills that left it malnutritioned. But now that they've got the best mum in the world, and the best dad in the world, and the best this, that, and the other, all up and down the hallway, they now have enough love emotional vitamin pills to sink a battleship. So I can now speak to that little kid in Jesus' name and say, in Jesus' name, be healed. And grow and grow, and I think someone is right now, and grow and grow and grow and grow and grow and grow in the name of Jesus. Is someone feeling some stirrings inside or growing? Because the Lord's, doesn't matter, don't say anything. But the Lord's anointing is really very powerful on that. He is desirous that everyone who has been wounded like that grow. And here's the interesting thing. When I finish saying grow, and you kind of plateau out for a little bit, I then say, Lord, if it be your will, would you please reveal to this person how old that child is? Many times, the exact age of that child that is now grown up, they can grow up 15 years in 3 minutes, whatever the thing is. But wherever the Lord stops, next week, come back, we will examine what happened at that time in your life, give it to Jesus, get him into that room under new management, and then see that inner child grow up more, and then when it plateaus out and stops again, there's something else that the Lord wants to deal with. So you can actually use the inner child as stepping stones as to what really needs to be given to the Lord, and he will not go past an issue in that he knows has damaged someone in their lives. Let me give you an example of here. It's actually my mum. When she was 7 years of age, she's now gone to be with the Lord, so is Dad, but when she was 7 years of age, they were living in Maryborough, which was a land flowing with milk and honey. It was before the Depression. They were well known, they were in high society, very well off. The Depression hit, and they nearly went bankrupt. So they had to leave Maryborough and come to Brisbane, where they started up a shop on Ipswich Road there, a cake shop, which was pretty wussy as far as Granddad was concerned. Anyway, Mum went to school, and the teacher said, I'm going to lock you in the cupboard until the rats eat you. And after school, the kids grabbed her, locked her in the toilets, which they had, you know, the outside toilets in those days, in schools, I don't know if any of you remember those, down the back paddock, where she was screaming till 8 o'clock at night. Now, the trauma from going from a land of milk and honey to a land of absolute criminal abuse, on that day, Mum died. I grew up with a 7-year-old mum. And when she was 73, 74, by then the Lord had shown me how to grow them up. And for nearly 24 hours, the Lord took an issue, and she actually felt it go up through her skull to the cross. So she just lay in bed, literally seeing her whole life flash before her over a 24-hour period. And when that was finished, I could then speak to that inner child and command it to be healed and to grow. So I ended up with a grown-up mum for about 3 years before she died. And that was an incredible thing that happened. But Dad may have only been one or two. And I believe I had something very similar in me for most of my life as well. I now feel bigger on the inside than I do on the outside. And when you come to that place, oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Because that other, the starving refugee thing is just painful. And if I had to put a figure on it, I reckon about 90% of towns, all England and just about everywhere else in the world is like it. How's that? That's not exaggerating. So growing up the inner child is really, really important to me. So been through the rooms, jackhammered the concrete slab, now get that little kid grown up. And if they say, oh no, I don't feel anything, still do it, and they will either testify to stirrings, or most people testify to, every time I say grow, they feel like a balloon is somehow or other swelling them out on the inside. And if you give them another 9 months, within 9 months after that, because it takes a little while for them to have you ever heard the expression grow into your pores? Anyone heard that expression? No. Let me give you another, one or two. It takes them a little while to adjust to who this new person is in them. A person, you see, that little starving refugee, the enemy can see that little kid, and like vultures, pick on it, attack it, make its life hell. But when they see a giant standing here, they are just a little bit more concerned, which is why they hate me. But that's a compliment. It's a backhanded compliment, but it's still a compliment, okay? Yeah, because if they hate me, oh, thank you, Lord, because the Lord loves me. Another little aspect, apart from the inner child, that is so real, and if ever you're dealing, counselling anyone, please ask them if you can pray for their inner child to grow. And, yeah. All right, next. Inner child of the body, soul and spirit. I put that particular picture in for a very good reason. One lady who was sexually abused from very, very early childhood on had become dissociated. Her spirit, her soul and her body were actually disassociating. Now, anyone who does any psychology studies here, you'll know there is such a thing as a dissociation, okay? But check this out for a cure. After we'd done all of that, I said, Lord Jesus, in your name, I command body, soul, and spirit to unite. Because when I asked the Lord to show her something about herself, you know, how he saw her, she saw something like that. Her body, soul, and spirit actually holding hands. And one of them said, it's okay, we're going to be together soon. And then I prayed for them to come together in unity, to be made whole in the precious name of Jesus. And she literally jumped a little bit. But then she said this, oh, I can hear the birds outside. Now, would anyone like to guess why? Because when sound has to go from the body through to the spirit, soul, through the spirit, it, to her, it was like listening through a tunnel, like listening to sound through a tunnel. But when she became united, body, soul and spirit, it didn't have to travel all that. Oh no, I can't use the words for it. I just know that when she heard that bird, it was because she was unified, body, soul and spirit, and it didn't have to travel from one to the other. It's just an incredible thing. We are made out of a body, a soul and a spirit. And that's what dissociation can do. And there are many people who in traumas dissociate because life can be a little bit easier that way, so they think. if I can dissociate from myself, who I don't like, who I don't want to be with, if I can move aside, then I don't have to be with me, because I don't like me. I don't like who I am, rah, 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 rah. So they dissociate. But the Lord can unite them. Here are some pictures I saw on Google. I Googled these. And let's give you an example of a woman in a fetal position, a girl in a fetal position, almost nursing that in a child. I tend to believe, and I've got no evidence of this, when some older people go into that second childlike state, I often wonder if that little kid now has the ascendancy over the physical. And so I think my first recommendation would be to pray for those little kids to grow. This one on the end is, can you see the little kitty there in the stomach? She is comfort feeding her kid. And that inner child, I believe, is responsible for a whole lot of anorexia, bulimia, anxiety, depression, obsessive compulsive disorders. Obsessive compulsive disorders all over the place. Anything that can smother or cover or blank out the pain of that little kid. One woman used to have roller doors on her garage, and 30, 40 times a day she'd put the roller drawers up and down to make sure they were locked and all that kind of thing, because it's much easier to do that than have to deal with that broken little hearted kid in there, which many people don't know how to deal with. This is a sculpture I use on my YouTube. It says a whole lot. It's absolutely a beautiful sculpture. Him, her, with inner children that just want to be together, but pride and all the rest of that stuff and moodiness and goodness knows what, they just got their back to back. But get them grown up, and that's good. I often, in marriage counselling, Lord, would you please show her something about him? And Lord, would you please show him something about her? The most recent last week was, he's an anchor. She wanted to punch his lights out. And the Lord, she said, what's an anchor got to do with it? Well, have you ever heard of the Lord being an anchor to our souls and a stabilizing influence and a place of stability and all the rest of that stuff? So I think she's taking that to heart, and so she should. This guy is James Barry. If you know, he wrote Peter Pan. If ever there was a guy with an inner child, this is it. And I believe Peter Pan was actually a manifestation of the inner child of a trauma that he had in his life. I'll just put my glasses on. What happened was, David, his mother's favourite, died 2 days before his 14th birthday in an ice skating accident. This left his mother devastated, and Barry tried to fill David's place in his mother's attention, even wearing David's clothes and whistling in the manner that he did. One time, Barry entered her room and heard her say, "Is that you?" "I thought it was a dead boy. I thought it was my dead brother she was speaking to," wrote Barry in his biography accounts of his mother, Margaret Ogilvy. "I said in a little lonely voice, 'No, it's no him, it's just me.'" Now, for a whole range of reasons, that kid stopped taking his love emotional vitamin pills when his brother died in that skating accident. And I believe Peter Pan is actually a story of the inner child that James Barrie had, that he didn't want to grow up because his mum didn't want him to grow up. And he just talked about the chaos and the trauma of it, that inner child being formed in there. Puts a different perspective onto Peter Pan, doesn't it? Everyone has a story. There's a thing called Adult Inner Child Anonymous. Inner children guess at what's normal. They have difficulty in following a project from beginning to end. They lie when it would be just as easy to tell the truth. They judge themselves without mercy. They have difficulty having fun. They take themselves seriously. And on it goes, because they are in a malnutritioned state. Very impulsive. They're extremely loyal, even in the face of evidence that the loyalty is undeserved. And you can Google stuff like that, and you can Google traits of the inner child of alcoholics. The inner child, having an alcoholic parent produces one of these kids. Anyone with an addiction, here's what an addiction is. It's like looking down a pipe. This is my definition, by the way. Like looking down a pipe, and all you see at the end of that pipe is the bong, the syringe, the horse race, the poker machine. And because it takes up all the focus of your mind, where are your loved ones? Oh, out there somewhere. And they only become useful to you in supplying what you require for your addiction. Addictions are caused when a discovery is made. D-I-S-C-O-V-E-R-Y. They do that and it makes them feel good, lifts the burden and that felt good. Once they make a discovery, they are literally hooked. People who smoke make a discovery that it makes them feel better for a while, until they get the smoker's cough and lung cancer and everything else. And many who smoke don't get lung cancer, I'm well aware of that, but it still tars up the lungs. What else? Whatever the discovery they make, that's what they are now addicted to. Okay. Any questions so far? I like dealing with the initial cause. Let's take pornography as a major addiction. Real men don't watch porn. Okay? If I said that outside these walls, I could be stoned. I could be taken out and stoned. Because there are eight chemicals are released and hormones are released when watching pornography. The two of the most dangerous are oxytocin and PEA. Oxytocin occurs when you're watching pornography and oxytocin is released and you bond with a two-dimensional picture. Oxytocin occurs when women breastfeed, and it's what bonds them to the child, to their child. And it's God's doing it. It's marvelous in our sight. But to be bonded to a two-dimensional picture ain't no good. The other one is PEA, phenylethylamine, which means that phenylethylamine is just like crack cocaine, and that's one of the chemicals that's released during watching pornography, and that makes you a crack cocaine addict. Any person who is an addict to crack cocaine you can't really say is a real man, can you? Because they're an addict. They're looking that way. And so, at the risk of being very unpopular, real men don't watch pornography. Next, anything else? No. All right. Very quickly now, I want to go through grief, relationship issues, sexual abuse, anxiety, grief, two griefs there. Is that the second one? Depression. How are you going? It's a bit of an overload, but you can really think about some of this stuff later. I intend to try and put that on my YouTube channel, what we're doing today, so if you forget about it, I can't remember it, hopefully in a week, a fortnight, 3 weeks, it'll be on YouTube and you can refresh your minds then. Okay? Grief. We talked a bit before about the grief tunnel. Mrs. Kubler-Ross wrote the book on death and dying, and she's more or less the high priestess of grieving. She drew graphs like that. And denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance are the five major ones. Anyone who goes through the grief tunnel will experience anger at the loss. It's pretty normal to experience anger at a loss. If someone steals your car, you might get very angry about it, steal your purse, whatever. It's reasonably normal to get angry. The Bible says, be angry, but don't sin. That means be angry at the loss that's occurred, but don't go and punch someone's lights out. Because then you've stepped over a mark, over a line, and you're angry with sinning. It's very interesting that people, when they're dying, I used to be a palliative care volunteer in the hospital and staying with people in those last months of their lives to see that, and to know that they are actually grieving their own passing before they die, because they have to go through, oh no, it can't be cancer, it can't be this, it can't be that. Then they get angry at the disorder. Then they, God, if you save me from this, I'll be a priest for the rest of my life or whatever. People in the trenches in World War I, II used to do exactly that. Depression. Anger hasn't worked. Bargaining with God hasn't worked. So they actually go into depression. Nothing works. Oh, well, acceptance. And if they come to acceptance, their grief has been positive. If they do not work through that and internalize it, then they can go right down to suicide. And that's grief taking its ultimate toll on a person's life. That's why we need to go through those rooms, clean them out, so that the grief that person has will lead them to a healthy acceptance. In fact, there is a lot of research done, clinical research, on some Syrian refugees and refugees in general that were tortured and goodness knows what, really badly treated. So check this out. That's where they started. X marks the spot. They were taken away, tortured and done, and everything horrible happened to them. Then they worked their way back. And that's where they started, and some of them can actually work their way much further forward, and there's a thing called Beyond Zero. Some of them can actually end up as much better people than they were before all the traumas happened in their lives. But there are five things that the clinical research shows that a person must go through for that to happen. They must believe, and this is secular research, not Christian research. It's set research in the world, okay? Done by authorities involved with helping refugees. They must believe in a God that it cares and loves them. It didn't actually matter which kind of God they believed in, but provided they believe in a God that cares and loves them. Number two, they must have hope that things are going to get better. Number three, they must have tender hearts, not chips on shoulders. They must have tender hearts. Fourth one I've forgotten, sorry. And the fifth one is the courage to implement all of those attributes. And if they do, they will actually end up much better people than when they started. So we can all, if we had those five attributes, go to a place in life where we would never wish it on our worst enemy. But boy, we know that we are now better people through having been through all of those life experiences. Next, and this is a much bigger list than Mrs. Kubler-Ross. It's on her five stages, denial, anger, bargaining, acceptance, depression, acceptance. Here's a much bigger list. Now, if any of you have gone through some difficult stages where there's been big loss in your life, would you please, in your mind, tick the boxes and, if necessary, say, yeah, that was about 70%. Oh, that was 100%. Oh, that was a 3 out of 10. No, that didn't affect me much. Oh, that was pretty big. And just each one, identify how your being, your life, responded to the loss. I'm going to read them out. Continually thinking about the losses that have occurred, your mind will spin, absolutely spin with the losses. Wishing that it were all different. Well, that's a no-brainer, okay? But it's still there. Being afraid you're going crazy. You can actually think that you're going insane. Now, let me tell you why. For those of you who can picture things, see that picture in my hand? I go over to Kathy, hit her on the big toe with a hammer. Okay? Do you know that her life is going to go into chaos for the next 5 minutes before she retaliates and my life goes into chaos? Okay? Or you might do it instantly. I don't know. I'm not going to do it. But you're afraid that with that chaos happening in there because of the pain, you think your life's going into chaos. If Kathy felt zilch, zero, nothing, would there be something wrong with Kathy? Perhaps a broken spinal cord? Well, there can be diabetes, leprosy, who knows? There'd have to be something really wrong with Kathy for that pain not to go from the big toe up the spinal cord to the brain. The fact that your life is now in trauma and in chaos actually means you're perfectly normal. I didn't say it was nice. I just said it was normal. And if someone in loss thinks that they're going stark raving insane, bonkers, then that means that they are healthy in their emotional life, and that's an appropriate emotion to the loss. Being unable to function in normal activities. Yes. Let me explain that one a bit. Some of you here would know a lot about cane cutting. I don't. But the first mechanical cane cutter that was ever made had a very, very weak engine powering it. and it had it drove an oil pump with servo motors to all the whirly gigs and wheels and everything else. Okay, I heard a yes over there, so here goes. It was such a weak engine that they couldn't switch everything on else all at once, or the engine would just stall and say, I give up, and stop. It didn't say I give up, but that's what it did. And so what they do is they use a few of the whirly gigs, cutters and things, switch them off, and then switch some wheels on, move a bit forward, switch them off, turn something else on, switch it off, turn something else on, switch it off. So they could only use a small number of things at each time. That has got to be one of the best examples of what happens to a person in grief. Because one moment, their mind will shut down and you just can't think. Then your mind will come back online, but your body just wants to collapse in bed. And then that will come back online, and something else within you will shut down. And so in 1 hour, like Melbourne's weather, you can have four different startups and shutdown. You can be happy one moment and crying your eyes out the next. It's if you listen to your very life, it knows how to heal you and how to get you through that grief tunnel. So listen to it, and I know you have to work, even though your mind wants to shut down, even though you'll be unable to function in normal activities, but you might be able to do something. But I tell you what, if it wants to shut your brain down, it will. So just go with the flow as much as you can, because it knows how to heal you. The worse you feel in a loss, the shorter the tunnel. The more you block it, the longer the tunnel. Take your pick. It's the only sickness that the sicker you get, the faster you heal. All right? It's the only sickness that heals itself. If you can twist that round in your mind somehow or other. Feeling that time is suspended or altered. Oh, a minute can seem, you're in a time warp. A minute can seem like an hour can seem like a minute. You're just floating around there. Crying, being angry, being guilty. Feeling shame, feeling helpless, feeling depressed, feeling hopeless, feeling life isn't real, feeling aimless, feeling lost. They are all, if someone comes into you complaining of all of those, you say, oh, well, that's okay, that just means you're normal. Now let's get to some of these rooms where the losses have occurred, and let's ask the Lord what you need to give to him, and for these losses to start being addressed. Grieving is a process with many different emotions. Keep reminding yourself, it's okay to feel these jumbled feelings. That's a term I use all the time. Do you have, because most people can't identify the feelings in there. There's so many of them, and they're all mixed up. So I just use the word, have you got a whole lot of jumbled feelings in there? And that's good for guys, because guys say, yeah. And that's about as close as we can get to some of the stuff that's happening in there, okay? Some guys can really identify it well. I can't. In fact, when I'm feeling like happy as a pig in mud, this goes for the guys, when I'm feeling happy as a pig in mud, that's when I feel like a real man. Now, any other guy relate to that, when you just feel happy as a pig in mud? No, just me. Okay, moving on. For a time you may feel you're emotionally moving away from your family, and indeed you may need to disconnect for a time in order to have a healthy reconnection when you are stronger. The losses, here goes, The losses having been fully felt are now absorbed or integrated into your personality as either a positive or a negative. The most negative things in our lives can become the most powerful positive attributes of our character. So let them integrate, let them be internalized in our lives until they become the most powerful positive attributes of our character. Now, very quickly, change the topic again. By the way, you're doing well. We might have an early mark today, but we'll see. We'll see. No promises. Okay? Relationship issues. I want to give you a rule of thumb for helping married couples. Invented by me, but here goes. Well, sort of. I stole a lot of ideas from a lot of people. I mean, I acquired a lot of ideas from a lot of people. Okay. All right. There's a blank slate. Let's go. There's a male. There's a female. There's a ruler from 1 to 10 for the male. There's a ruler from 1 to 10 for the female. Did you know that every female has one question? And I believe it's the question that God put into Eve in the Garden of Eden when he said, "And your desire shall be towards your husband." Because, by the way, that's the best answer for anything, just because. All right, moving right along. He actually knows what he's doing. I mean, let's get real here. I don't think it would work without it. Now, here's how it goes. When he said, "And your desire shall be towards your husband," that word desire is the same word desire that Eve had for the fruit. She desired it. That fruit was so yummy and gorgeous looking that it was an incredible desire that drove her to breaking God's commands. That same desire is what a woman has towards a husband. And here's what it is in English. Not Hebrew, English. Because I don't know it in Hebrew. But you have to learn it off by heart, guys. Because every woman will know this intuitively in their hearts. Every woman who has not been abused by a husband or abused by men and has buried this question right out of her life. But for those who are healed and whole, this is a question that guys have to know off by heart. Is what I am, everything about me, my goals, my ambitions, my desires for the future, my plans, the giftings on my life, everything. Is what I am beautiful enough to pursue, and will he come after me? How's that for an incredible statement? Now, I'm going to do something really scary here. Now, you don't have to participate in this if you do not want to. How many women here can actually identify and relate to that question? Thank you. Is what I am beautiful enough to pursue, and will he come after me? Because the problem is, if a guy does not answer that question to a woman, she will feel in many ways destroyed. It's that serious. So, that's her question. Let's go to the next bit. That's her question. When looking at the male, what skills does he have to answer her question? Does he have a lot of skills? Has he been brought up in a nurturing environment by the age of five, where he was warmly bonded? And that's the only terms I'll use, warmly bonded to mum and warmly bonded to dad. Because if he has been warmly bonded to mum and dad, he will automatically know the nurturing that he got, and he can then give that to his wife. If he's been brought up in a abusive situation and has not had that warm bonding, it can take decades for a guy to learn how to be relational. How do I know? Because I've been one of those guys. I told you mum was seven and dad was only about one or two in their inner child. And our family was like rigidly disengaged, like icebergs on the sea. Yes, we all came from one glacier, but just detached, rigidly disengaged. We're not now, but that's how it was. So what skills does he have to answer her question? Is he able to say, yes, you are beautiful enough to pursue, and yes, I am coming after you? That's my wife over there, who I think is all of those things. Next. So, on a scale from 1 to 10 for the male, what skills does he have to answer a question? Oh, no, he's too interested in going to the pub. He gets a 1 out of 10. Oh yeah, that he likes spending time with her and they do things together. Oh, 9.999999 recurring out of 10. Okay? What openness does she have to receive his attempts? Many times there are women who have been so hurt that they are like a clamshell that is just clammed up. And her ability, no matter how hard he tries, she will not receive it. And so she goes to a one. But then there are those women who are what I call, here's a new word for you, okay? Husbanded. Husbanded. Say it. Husbanded. Good, you're doing well. And you can tell those women that are husbanded. And there is just that glow about them. There is just that loving to be with the one who answers their question. Check this out, will you? Now, that is obviously. What is that obviously? Ah, mountain. Who said that? Very good, Paul. My grade 2 teacher was wrong about my artwork. I'll remember that. So, here we have a mountain. And on the side of it, we have a spring of water. The spring of water goes down the side of the mountain, into the river, and then out into the ocean. How's that? Very good artwork. It's a river. There are always art critics around, aren't there? It's just terrible. I'll never get through this. All right, so that is the kaphele, K-A-P-H-E-L-E in the Greek, which means the head or the source or the beginning. Jesus is the source of the church, which is the river. Jesus doesn't have to dominate, intimidate, manipulate or control. He just ministers to the church and he actually answers my question, which we'll come to in a minute. And that goes, and the church is a river, and the church looks back to Jesus as our source of all things. How's that? Not because there's any manipulation or anything forcing there. It's just we know that that's where our source of life comes from. In an identical way, there is the husband pouring fresh living water into his wife, who becomes full of crystal clear water, full of great big barramundi, full of life, because he is pouring all of that into her. If the guy does not have the skills to minister to his wife, or she has puts a dam wall as the water's coming down the hill, then the woman will end up like a dried out creek bed with stagnant pools of blue-green algae and dead fish along the muddy banks. And when they come in, within a matter of minutes, you can see that he either A, does not have the skills to answer her question, or B, she has a closure to receiving it, or a sliding scale of both. It's really, that thing I invented really helps me to discern where the problems are in a very simple way. There's a man's question, much simpler than a woman's. Am I a real man? Guys, we should be able to identify with that one, okay? Am I a real man? Now, here goes. There's Kathy. There's me. There's Jesus, because we have been made a little lower than the angels, or a little lower than God in some translations. And there's God the Father. Okay? Kathy, me, Jesus, God the Father. All right. I can answer Kathy's question. Is what I am beautiful enough to pursue, and will he come after me? I can answer that. No woman on this planet can ever answer a man's question. You wouldn't know how to. Seriously, that's not an insult, that's just you wouldn't know how to. And besides, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you are calling out for your question to be answered. How's that? Now, well, someone's got to answer my question. So, I go to my head, which is Jesus. And by sitting 10, 15 minutes a day in his presence, by reading his word, telling him I love him, and all that kind of thing, did you know that my masculinity and my manhood is validated by Jesus, my head? So, when my masculinity is validated, my manhood is validated, I can go to Kathy for her more than for me. It's just an incredible process. I've now got something to give, because I got it from Jesus. And Jesus goes to the Father, and the Father has given Jesus a name above every name. And at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. So the Son has had a name above every name. That's pretty good validation, isn't it? So we each go to our heads to have our questions answered. I hope that, yeah. Absolutely. Right on. anyone here seen the DVD called Absent? ABSENT. Let me just, if you haven't, it's well worth watching on iTunes or wherever else, or getting the DVD. It's Absent, ABSENT. It talks about absentee fathers. And it's done by the guy who wrote Wild at Heart, John, Aldridge. Yeah. Okay. He's actually in the movie. He's actually in the documentary. And they interview three people. Oh, even if you watch just the trailer of it, you know, on IMBD or whatever it's called, just Google the trailer of Absent. Now, in the trailer, they interview three people. One is James someone or other, who's one of the lead guitarists in Metallica. What's his surname? Anyone know his surname? Nope. Okay, James. We'll call him James. I know that much. The other one is a prostitute in Los Angeles. The third one is a world-famous boxer who has had 5 world champions. Just to reinforce your point. Okay, James, one of the guys in Metallica. He came home from school one day, and there was a note written to his mother. And the dad said, "I'm out of here," or something like that. I don't know what was on the note, but his dad left that day. And James in the interview says, "He left a note. And it wasn't even to me." At that day, I believe James, in a child, died. This is why this adult inner child thing is so important. I believe that his inner child died. Malnutrition of love, emotional vitamin pills from that day on. And I believe from that time on, he went into some pretty sex, drugs, rock and roll, all that stuff, as a way of anaesthetizing the pain of that malnutrition little kid in there. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, I hope you're getting the concept of this inner child. Now, the other thing is the prostitute in Los Angeles. She said in this trailer, what advice would she give to other women? Oh, sad. I've been pretty good today. Not to look for her daddy's love everywhere. I did it. Not to look for her daddy's love everywhere. That puts a whole different perspective on it, doesn't it? Number three. This world-famous boxer. Because Dad wasn't there to protect him and tell him how to step up, because Dads tell kids their sons how to step up into that new thing. And because he had to go it alone, his life, he felt, was a big fight from day one. He actually interpreted that as fighting in the boxing ring. Because of that inner child that had... I know someone who was a very famous... I think it was weightlifter in Queensland, very famous weightlifter. And he developed all those muscles just to protect that little kid in there. Because of the abuse that his father gave him. I know that guy very well, very personally. Okay, back to the boxer. Life was a battle. And he saw life as a battle because Dad wasn't there to take the load off him and make it less of a battle. You see, in every guy, there is a warrior spirit. You hearing me, guys? In every guy, there is a warrior spirit. And that warrior spirit can either attack our families, your families, or our families, or protect our families from outside contamination. And that's what the warrior spirit's in there to protect our families. But domestic violence, it turns inward and attacks a family. I hope this is not an information overload. Even if you think about it later, or something, I'm hoping that when someone comes along and they've got an issue like this, what I'm saying now will just pop up. Okay, let's go for it. Okay, that's about all male and female relationships I want to do. And a guy says, well, it seems very one-sided. All I've got to do all year is just answer her question, you know. What's in it for me? And by the way, what's in it for me is actually one of the major questions that guys ask. All right. Sorry, but it is. All right. Moving right along. Now, that's it. Happy wife, happy life. What's in it for you? Here goes. Everything is. By the way, on my YouTube, I've got sessions 9A, B, C, and D. A, B, C, and D. Watch session D first, because that's Mark Gungor. How to laugh your way to... Who's that, Mark Gungor? Yeah? Brilliant. He talks about men's brains and women's brains, and it's nothing boxes and all that stuff. And also after that, there's a session on Dr. Carolyn Leaf from South Africa, and she talks about one of the things she talks about is the insula, and the difference between the male insula in the brain, it's one of the structures of the brain, and a female insula in the brain. Now, the male insula is quite a large part of the corpus callosus. Cerebral cortex, that's what I'm trying to think of. Not the corpus callosus, which divides the left and right hemispheres, but the cerebral cortex. And with the male, it's a very large section. It's shaped like an almond. Now, the insula actually insulates the past from the present. So, in the morning we guys can go out, shoot Bambi, Thumper, Skippy the kangaroo, anyone else? Oh, the whole lot. We can go out, and we can bring them home that evening and enjoy a lovely venison dinner. Because the insula insulates what happened out there from what's happening here on the dinner table. And that's why guys say, what are you bringing that up for, woman? Because they haven't got a large insula, and thank God that they haven't, or nothing would be dealt with. I rest me case. I'm making enemies here today. As soon as I leave, they're going to tar and feather me or something. Anyway, women have a very small insula, which does not insulate the past from the present. And everything that happens to them is either now or yesterday. Can you relate? Can you relate what I'm saying? A little bit. And therefore, because it's not... they know it was 20 years ago. But it's like it was yesterday. And it's not that they're living in the past. It's actually that the past is living in them. So they can't get rid of it. The only way they can get rid of it is by processing it, and it must come with 5 months. It must come out the mouth in order to be processed. The whole five, yes. This is what confuses the guy, you see. We have one mind there, And by the time you've changed channels five times, we are confused as. Much to my credit, I can actually now hear when a woman changes channels. I think I'm doing pretty well. Oh, you may mock me, but I think I'm doing pretty well. For God, that's about as good as it gets. What's that? Teach? Okay. We haven't got time enough to address that one. That's my cop-out, by the way. Yeah. No, there are some things... in the scriptures it says, bear ye one another's burdens. And then it's, later on it says, but each man should carry his own load. So what are we going to do? Are we going to bear one another's burdens, or are we each going to carry our own load? And the answer is, in the Greek, the burden is like a massive granite boulder that's crushing the life out of a human being. Like the Good Samaritan, that's the person that was robbed and nearly killed. He couldn't get up and look after himself. So in those things, we have to bear one another's burdens. But the word, each man shall carry his own load, that word load is the same as a Roman soldier's knapsack. There are things that every soldier needs to be accountable for, the bedroll, the food rations, this. We're not to touch those. We're not to help each other with those. They're our individual responsibilities. But if something's a rock-crushing boulder, crushing the life out of someone, fine, we can do that. And by the way, only the Lord knows whether it's one or the other. Just to throw the cat among the pigeons. But really, it's not as simple as that. Only the Lord knows the difference. Yeah. Yep. When you've got five minds, it's almost impossible. It is impossible to imagine a mind with zero thoughts. Now, guess how many? Okay. Guess what I'm feeling right now. Who would like to guess? Who said it? What'd you say? Nothing. Absolutely. Right now, I'm feeling nothing. I am inert. It's no feelings, sense of well-being, but I'm not feeling anything. And most of the time I've been talking to you, I've been thinking of nothing. I know, I can hear myself talk to you. I can. But I think it comes more out of my heart than out of my brain. Yeah. Anyway, we'll leave that one with you. This next subject on sexual abuse. No, I'll do it here. As I said, I've dealt with over 1,000 sexual abuse victims, and I want to give you the heads up on a way to approach it. Now, because the vast majority of those 1,000 plus have been women, can you imagine how embarrassing it is for them to talk to me, and how terrified almost many of them are to have to talk to a man when their abuser was a man? It's quite a, it requires a lot of bravery, absolutely. So here's what I say, in order to help them feel more relaxed and more comfortable, etc., etc. Take the pressure off them. I say, I'm going to tell you what happened. And then my opening statements. Well, you've just told me you've been sexually abused, so I'm going to tell you what happened. They look at me as if it's gone from being a trinity to a quadruple or something like that. No, I don't know exactly what happened, but I know exactly what happened. And here's how I start. And then, of course, we pray for the inner child to grow, which puts them really back in the driver's seat of their lives. Okay, it's a bit different from psychotherapy, I know, but it works. It works for me anyway. And as long as the Lord keeps blessing people that way, I'm going to keep doing it. All right. Ooh. No questions, all right. Excuse me. Next. Anxiety. People are not born with anxiety. They may be born with a predisposition towards it, a genetic predisposition, but they are not born with anxiety. A predisposition means it's like an acorn or a seed, and providing that seed is not watered and fertilized, that tree will not grow. Providing it's not put in the ground, etc., that seed will not grow. And a predisposition, if not put in the ground and watered and fertilized, will not grow, so that person, even though they have a predisposition towards it, it's not going to happen. They can go through their lives without anxiety or without this or any other predisposition. Anxiety. When anyone has anxiety, I almost immediately go to the story of being in a war zone. On the YouTube, there's a whole thing on anxiety, 35 minutes or so on it. But here's how I start. You don't have to go to Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan to be in a war zone. You can have a war zone right under your roof, at home, where you're walking along one day, and someone throws a hand grenade at you. You idiot. That is a hand grenade. Or you can step on a landmine where someone comes and just belts the living daylights out of you. Or you can be in your room and someone comes with a rifle and tells you that you're no good and you're stupid. That's like a sniper taking a pot shot at them. So in a family can be a war zone, an absolute war zone. It can be the best place in the world to bring up a child, or right through to being the worst place in the world to bring up a child. Depending on the use of kind words, loving words, and gentle words. I'll come to that in a minute. If, however, their life has been in a war zone, and sexual abuse means that their life has been in a war zone, domestic violence means their life has been in a war zone, all the various addictions and things that send people around the twist can make a person, make a child's life in a war zone. So, how do you know? See that little old lady coming towards you? She's in this little village, grass hut village. Little old lady coming towards you. How do you know if she is the enemy? Well, does she have a whole lot of dynamite strapped to her, a suicide bomber? And is she coming towards me and detonating those bombs, that dynamite? I don't know. So everyone is now under suspect. And everyone can be a potential enemy. If they've got a head, a body, two arms and two legs, unless there's been some form of amputations there, they can, and even if they have been, they can still be the enemy of your soul. They can be the ones that judge you, criticize you, talk about you, gossip about you. So every human being on this planet has a chance now of being an enemy. Some people, when they go into the local shopping centre, get anxiety right up to the max, and even panic attacks. Why? Because they're surrounded by the enemy. And any one of those is after them. Any one of those wants to kill them. Wants to throw abuse at them. So, as you can see, being in a war zone creates anxiety. So in that case, I usually go through male and female parents' rooms. Bullying at school. Bullying at school is a great way to create post-traumatic stress disorders in a kid in later life. Post-traumatic stress disorders, not good. Let me think. It's being in a war zone. So you deal with the bullies, which we did last week. But they'll say, no, it's not anything to do with those bullies in the schoolyard. It's nothing to do with my parents who used to flog me a lot. It's nothing to do with any of those. It only happened last week. It has nothing to do with my past. Oh, yeah, yawn. Don't ever fall for that one. Every second of their life affects the next second, 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 the next second. Anything that hasn't been dealt with back there will affect them there. Join the dots, please, and find out where it came from. The Lord knows exactly where it came from. Ask Him. I've got so many cases I could quote, but here's one. This guy was 50 years of age. early 50s, 52, 53. Anxiety came on him very suddenly at that age. And here's what he would do. I don't know if I can do it. He would stand up on his toes, which I find very difficult to do at my age, stand up on his toes and tiptoe around the house and making sure all the windows were shut, all the doors were locked. He never did this in the rest of his life. He now started tippy-toeing around and making sure everything was sealed up and locked, and he used to go to the knife drawer and take out a knife while he was tippy-toeing around. A 50-year-old man tippy-toeing around the room. And he said, it started just about a couple of months ago, and I can't even leave the house. The fear and anxiety I have when I even go to the front door, I can't go there. I tried once to get him to the front gate. We managed to walk down the front gate and had to take him back again. So, what's wrong? Obviously, from what I've been saying today, something from the first couple of years of his life, always. Now, they may not be able to join the dots, but we have to. You see, there's only one way a young kid can deal with things. And that one way is to bury it alive. So something happens to a little kid, and they can't sit down like we are and say, well, now let's have a talk about this and let's internalize it, let's discuss it, let's look at all the complications. In fact, little kids can grieve more than big people because they have no verbal ability to explain or discuss it. They have to just internalize it, and their grieving can be very severe and come out in bedwetting, thumb sucking, stomach pains, headaches, and being very clingy. So that's the way a little kid grieves. All right, back to this 53-year-old man. When he was about 3, he had a male biological parent, I can't call him a father, who would come in, and when they're all sound asleep, grab them by the arm, throw them out of their beds while they were sound asleep, scare them into hell, and mum and the kids would have to run down the back front steps. He would then lock the doors and go to sleep and have the sleep all for himself. Many nights a week. Now, a kid can't process that, so they have to bury it alive. But I want to tell you, everything that's been buried alive has to come out one day. Everything. And what they would do, they would go back to the house and mum would take him and put him through the top of the door where he could just squeeze through, and he'd go down to the floor and then tippy-toe past his male biological parent's room so as not to wake him, because on the occasions where he woke him, he'd be literally thrown through the wall. He would tippy-toe past that room, unlock the door, and let mum and the rest of the kids come in. So, where did his anxiety come from? Those formative years. And one day I said, can't you see that what's happening to you now goes all the way back to, look, you're tippy-toeing. And I said, did you ever want to kill your father? He said, yes. I said, what did you want to kill him with, knowing fully well what the answer would be? And he said, a knife. I said, well, why do you think you're lugging a knife around the room with you? Because you are literally reenacting what occurred right back then. It's just, you only think it started now. It's been buried alive for 45 years. Whew. And he still didn't see it. Talk about thick. So, what do you do in that situation? You just say, Lord, in Jesus' name, would you please reveal to this guy? And I actually asked the Lord to join the dots, so the Lord could explain it in the Lord's way, give him the revelation that the Lord knew would sink through. And he was shocked. The Lord spoke to him, joined the dots, and he then saw that what happened at the age of 3, 4 was directly proportional and directly related to his 50-year-old experience. That was about 15 years ago. We're very good friends now, and he's involved with a lot of helping a lot of people because he knows how he's been helped. And he actually counsels the same way that I do now, and because he knew it worked with him. So that's just, is this more food? An army marches on its stomach. I hear that. All right, okay, anxiety, you've got it. A kid being in a war zone equals anxiety. Just find out where the war zone was. Let's have some afternoon tea.